Howdy folks, back working on this Cavalier Coca-Cola cooler, air-cooled one, with the Blissfield Tecumseh condensing unit, and it's become a problem child. I knew that the overload breaker was bad, and it would rapidly reset if it tripped just in a couple seconds, not give the compressor time to cool off or the pressure to go down. So I got another one here. This is a Supco overload out of a RO41 device for a quarter horsepower compressor. This one has a longer reset delay, which is good for the motor. So sadly, the original one here is not gonna be usable. So I'm fixing to take it out and replace it. This will be more or less a like-for-like replacement. Well, forgot to unhook it first. This will fit in there just like the original did. Same bracket and everything. So the overload is just the first part of the problem child issues. Also, I had done something yesterday with an external device so that I could let it run safely while I was trying to check the calibration on the thermostat. And I noticed that the run cycles were getting longer and longer. And then finally, one time, it had been running for, I don't know, probably an hour or more. And I noticed it caught my attention that it was still running and it wasn't cooling at all. Had very low power draw on the compressor and just not cooling. So what I think has happened, I think this one has moisture in it. There's no dryer. The capillary tube comes right off of the condenser. So if it picks up moisture, you know, there's just nothing to deal with that. So you're gonna have freeze ups. And I'm reasonably sure that's what happened. So I'm going to recover what's left of the charge in the system. Once I've done that, I'm going to install a service port stem onto the compressor and then put the vacuum pump on it. I'm going to let the vacuum pump run probably overnight and probably leave a heater blowing in here on the compressor to help make sure that we get all the moisture out. And then tomorrow, I'll solder in a dryer that'll take care of any residual moisture. And then she should be good to go. Alright, so I used a piercing valve to recover the system, but that's just temporary, and that segment of line will get cut out and replaced with a dryer anyway. But my problem right now, this service, the stem where the system was factory charged, is real short and almost kinked, and I don't know, that may be a pain in the tail to try to get that working. I won't be able to video it because the tripod's not low enough. But I'm going to try to cut it off behind the pinch off and see if I can open it up with the swaging tool, be able to get a stem in there. But I don't know what I'm going to do. I might end up having to melt it out of the compressor, but we'll see. Wish me luck. I'm going to need it. I was able to get the tubing cutter around it and get a pretty decent round cut. So maybe after all, I'll be able to get a stem in there, no problem. It doesn't look so bad. Open it out just a little bit. Yeah, something like that. Got the stem in place there with the gauges hooked up. See a little hole, that nitrogen purge going through. Again, that section is going to be cut out. That's where the dryer is going to go. Got the vacuum pump going over there, and I got a little warm air heater blowing in there to heat all this up overnight, and hopefully by morning time all the moisture will be gone and the dryer can be put in. And I just put tape over that puncture hole to allow it to pull vacuum, and so far so good. It is the next day, a little bit after noon, and I'm going to pick back up working on the problem child again. So overnight, I had the little electric heater you saw running right here, the warm air heater, and that was keeping the compressor warm. And at the same time, I had the vacuum pump connected, running and drawing off anything that evaporated or came out of the oil overnight. And before I left last night, I heated up the evaporator with the heat gun until it was very hot to help drive off any moisture. So hopefully the system is well dehydrated. And then this morning, I put dry nitrogen in to bring it back to atmospheric pressure. And then after that point, I cut out the line with the puncture hole in it where I evacuated the system. And I replaced that with a new filter dryer. So if any residual water was in there, or if any more is created, it should not get to the cold end of the capillary tube and cause a freeze up. So at this point, the nitrogen was evacuated back out. That ran for probably an hour with the vacuum pump. So I'm gonna charge it up and start it and see if the problem child will start behaving. That's gonna be what I'm hoping for anyway. All right. I've got the kilowatt meter set up for current draw. I have the gauges hooked up there. You can see we're still under vacuum. And I'm fixing to put some refrigerant in it. We're gonna see if the problem child is gonna behave now or not. So, remember before it would work, but after, I don't know, a couple hours of cycling, it would stop cooling. And I think that it was moisture in the system. And I think that because it had no dryer, it didn't even have a filter screen in the system at all. So it had no way to deal with any kind of moisture. So we're gonna let it draw some refrigerant from a can, get it kind of, not in a vacuum anymore. Got positive pressure in the system. Go for a start. That's a quarter horsepower compressor, and it's got two fairly robust fan motors on it to draw up some current. So that looks like a lot of amps, but when you consider the system design, I don't think that's too excessive. Still drawing out of the can. Line's getting a little warm. I remember the last of these Blissfield systems with their round spiral evaporator, they don't hold a lot of refrigerant. So this can that I'm using is a partial can already. So I'm gonna put in what's in this can. We'll let it stabilize a while and see what it does. It might actually be plenty already. We got a brand new overload breaker and a new start relay. They're not the exact ones it came with, but it is a current relay, start relay. It's not one of those timed or PTC devices. It's a real start relay. I have a lot of mixed feelings about the RO81 style relay. I have a lot of mixed feelings about the start side of it, because again, it's not really sensing whether or not the compressor's running. It just gives the start winding power for essentially a timed period of time. And internally, it's doing it by heat. It's thermal internally, but from a standpoint of what it does to the compressor, it's just giving a pulse of power to the start winding, and doesn't care whether it started or not, that pulse lasts the same amount of time. But the compressor starts very readily. It's running with the start winding engaged for too long. If the compressor has a lot of momentum or inertia to it, like a monitor top compressor with a big rotor, it might not get up to full speed before that start signal is finished. So those work, but I kind of prefer them for a testing device only, and I like the magnetic current relay for the start, honestly. That's my opinion. Okay, that partial can of refrigerant is in there. Everything looks good. Oh yeah, we got more heat in the condenser now than it ever had yesterday. We'll check the interior in a moment. I'm gonna put the cover back on the cooler, the lid on it, to trap the cold air, and then I'll come back again. Been running another maybe 5 minutes, and everything sounds and looks good. It's definitely cooling in there. This discharge line is just barely warm. Some of the sound you probably hear is the Kelvinator unit behind us. Some of the sound you probably hear, that Kelvinator cooler is behind me, behind the camera, just started up. So there's some extra fan noise going on. Camera's wanting to really wash out. That's cold in there. I don't know what's up with the camera with the automatic exposure setting not working on the video. Apparently, I must have changed some settings without realizing it, and I'm going to check into that. There we go. Got the contrast working like it should. Let's check the discharge air temperature. Discharge air, that's pretty good. Won't be long, that'll cycle off. Well, it just cycled off. Probably 10 seconds after I said that, or 10 seconds after I cut the video. That was our discharge air temp. I'm going to move the thermometer down here into the bottom of the cabinet. In this little assembly of stuff, so we can see what the cabinet temperature is going to stabilize at. Low speed fan is running. So my test for these is to put a bunch of water bottles in there, because water will freeze easier than any sort of a drink, because soft drinks have sugar and things in them that keep them from, that make it take lower temperature than water to freeze. And of course, beer has alcohol, so it can go down in probably in the 20s. But to be sure that we're not gonna have a major problem of a bunch of glass bottles freezing and busting of soft drink, if I put water bottles in there and they don't freeze in the medium center position on the dial, then I'm pretty confident that that whoever uses this isn't gonna have a bad surprise. So I'm going to cut the video for now and come back to it if anything interesting happens. Hopefully it keeps cycling and cooling like it's supposed to.